this joint video call?
Yep, yep.
Sorry, Ms. Hickman, just a moment, please. Are we streaming? Sorry, Ms. Hickman, just a moment. Just sorting out camera angles. I think the problem was the sound quality, and I think some members of the press, as a consequence, have now been joined. I've got some. Is that working, Alice?
Yes, of
course. Right. I think we're working from a streaming point of view. I think it's as satisfactory as we can make it. Mr. Hickman, just before you resume, may I just ask one matter? It's generally thought that for the purposes of people that are travelling in, particularly by public transport. If we can sit again at 11 o'clock tomorrow and rise at 4:15 today, that would work better. But I need to ask you and Sir James whether or not that's going to accommodate everyone's submissions.
I can't speak for Sir James, I'm sorry.
How long do you think you will be?
That won't be a problem at all.
Sorry? How long do you think you will be, Ms. Hickman, this afternoon? Right, so is Sir James going to be able to get started today?
I certainly hope so, yes.
Yes, well, that's what I had anticipated. Sir James, how long do you anticipate being?
No problem with the timing, sir.
Good, excellent. Well, in that case, just for everyone making their own personal arrangements, we'll say that we'll rise at 4:15, give or take, this afternoon, and we'll sit again at 11 o'clock tomorrow morning. Yes, Mr. Hickman.
I said at the outset that on cases that there are various factors that point in the same direction here, and one of those is international law, which we deal with in our skeleton argument of 46 through to 54. If I can ask you just to turn that up, so all the court and you'll see paragraph 48 of our skeleton argument, we set out Article 15 of the Universal Declaration of Law.
Mr. Hickman, before you leave international law, Can I just ask you a few questions about this? First of all, I entirely understand your submission that Article 15 is part of customary international law. But I noticed that in the UN Special Rapporteur's submissions at footnote 54, they make the point that the Universal Declaration is not a treaty. I think its status actually is that it was a resolution of the General Assembly of the UN. But I don't think it matters to your fundamental argument, does it? Because you say, although this is not a treaty obligation, it is part of customary international law. That I understand. All you need for present purposes, and you may be wrong, and we'll hear the government in due course, but all you need, I think, for present purposes is the proposition that Article 15 is part of customary international law. Now, the way in which you couched the proposition a moment ago was the well-known presumption that legislation should be interpreted so as to conform to this country's international obligations. But I thought, certainly the Special Rapporteur appears to go slightly further and suggests that because this is a norm of customary international law, it is actually part of the domestic common law. That's helpful, thank you. My last question on the UN Special Rapporteur submissions arises from paragraph 21, subparagraph 5. It's 21, subparagraph 5. Now, as I read that subparagraph, they at least appear to contemplate a situation could arise where it's not possible to give full effect to a fair procedure, but nevertheless, there are national security reasons for depriving someone of citizenship. And they suggest that what international law then requires is that you seek a court's endorsement that this is strictly necessary. It's not suggesting there, as I read it, that you never could do this. No, I understand it's not your submission, but it might be said to be against you.
To ask the question why
Thank you.
Pause for a minute, would you, Mr. Hickman?
Sorry.
We seem to have some problems at this end. Just one moment, please.
It's fine.
Apparently we're working again. Do carry on.
Explained in paragraph 60 why the way that First of all, paragraph 444. The critical question to which it will come is whether article 2 of the US in third countries are or may be relevant considerations for the Secretary of State when she decides whether or not to deprive a citizen's life outside the UK. They talk about this being by analogy with the conserving principle. And the conclusion which the court reaches is that ordinarily that's not required. And in this case, it wasn't required because the individual may or may not choose to go to that country in question. But there was an exception recognised, and that's paragraph 50. And she, and it's this, in the middle of that paragraph, she, being the Secretary of State of Council, gave two practical examples of cases in which the Secretary of State practice would prevent deprivation. The first was a petition for the detention state, which routinely subject prisoners to Article 3 criminal treatment, but in which British citizens are better treated in detention than citizens of other states. Well, that's obviously not this case. In such a case, a direct consequence of deprivation will be the exposure of the requisite level of risk in the practice of criminal law. The second is a British citizen who is detained in a second state, which, if he were deprived of his nationality, would deport him, rather than to the United Kingdom, to a third state in which he would face a brutal torture. And so, the point being made is that you've got someone in detention, and it's not in their own free will where they are moved to, then the Secretary of State has to consider the risks in the countries which they might be removed to. Because once you've taken away the possibility of the person being returned to the United Kingdom, then the Secretary of State has to look at the countries to which they might be taken. But that is the point on which we relied. Now, we have a further way of putting this Article 3 case, which I'll just very briefly explain. We said that there was a real risk that the appellant would be removed to either Bangladesh or Iraq, and in both cases, without doubt, a level of risk of mistreatment that was easily sufficient. But we said, what's the alternative? The alternative is that she languishes indefinitely in detention in northern Syria. And so we said that by removing her citizenship, the Secretary of State was also taking away the possibility, the real possibility, that she could return to the United Kingdom. And critically, we established that her situation in the Al-Hoj camp and the Al-Hol camp were so squalid and so horrid that they amounted to conditions met the threshold of inhumane degrading treatment under Article 3. So our point was that by taking away the possibility of her returning to the United Kingdom, the Secretary of State, by depriving her of her citizenship, was exposing her to a real risk of her remaining longer than she would otherwise have done in those conditions. And that's the way we put the argument. We said, therefore, the policy was breached. Whether you look at it in terms of onward transfer, or whether you look at it in terms of the appellant remaining where she was. Now, I need just to look at the ministerial submission again, just to see what the Secretary of State was told, and then to look at Sykes' ruling on this point. So, the Secretary of State, first of all, page 186, but is told that there are So I was going to approach the issue. And it said in that paragraph, we remind ourselves we're not deciding this question on its merits. We must approach it by applying the principles of judicial review. To which I think may be, when can we reasonable? Now, then in the middle of paragraph 139, it is there, it is crucial that only material which the Secretary of State had, which was relevant to the policy, so it is crucial that the only material which the Secretary of State had, which was relevant to the policy, was the material in an annex to his submission. Of course, that's right, so all the Secretary of State has was the material we've seen, was the very terse statement in the submission, and then the two annexes that we've had, if we look at. So I then conclude, in our judgment, the Secretary of State was reasonably entitled to rely on the material. The Secretary of State's assessment of the material, reasonably entitled the Secretary of State to decide that, as respects their circumstances, at the time of the decision would not breach the policy because it would not change the risk as long as not foreseeable and direct consequence. That wasn't there. In my submission, that is, first of all, exceptionally compressed reasoning, but clearly limiting its reasoning to the material before the Secretary of State. It's not looking at any of the other evidence of the risks that were known or to which the Secretary of State should have been aware at the time the decision was taken. And then it goes on, we also consider on the material, again, limiting to the material. The Secretary of State is not required to speculate about the future. For example, the possibility that they might be removed to Syria and Bangladesh, Iran. Nor is he required to speculate about the possibility that at some point in the future they might be returned. But that's despite the case that all of those possibilities have been raised in the materials that we've looked at, but discounted. And yet, unless one is discounting upon the fact that they wouldn't be direct consequences, there's no reason to discount that those are risks that have to be assessed. And they can't be discounted as risks that are not direct consequences for the reason I showed you in X2, paragraph 50, which says that risks of onward transfer when people are in detention, and that transfer will therefore be not something that they have chosen to agree to, are direct consequences. So that's what we get from Syme. Now, I have a number of submissions on what approach that Syme has taken. My first submission is that Syme is wrongly taking a form of judicial review approach when it should be asking itself the question of whether at the time of the decision there was a real risk of whether at the time of the decision the appellant was exposed to a real risk of treatment that would contravene Article 3 or Article 2 if it was engaged. And instead of asking itself that question, SIAC thought it was reviewing the decision of the Secretary of State. Now, in support of that submission, first of all, I'd just like to refer to how the Secretary of State put the issue in the Secretary of State's argument before SIAC, and you have that in the bundle at tab E, page 141.
So tab E of the core bundle.
At the time of the decision, she was exposed it's not said that SIAC is just adopting a Wednesbury reasonable approach, or that SIAC should not consider any of the material that was put forward by the appellant. On the contrary, it's been accepting that the appellant is going to put forward material about those risks which need to be considered by SIAC. Secondly, if this was a deportation case, and SIAC was considering for itself an appeal from a decision of the Secretary of State to deport someone, there's no question that it would have been asking itself the question whether or not there was a real risk of exposure to Article 3 or Article 2 mistreatment. You can see that very clearly with a number of authorities that established that proposition, but if I could take you to one in tab 12 of the authorities bundle.
Do you want me to say something?
Yes.
Mr. Hickman, can I... Sorry to interrupt everyone. Lady Justice King has dropped off for the moment. So if you can just bear with us.
I'm back. Sorry about that, Mr. Hickman. I think I lost you just when you had taken us to paragraph 4 of ASVD.
Yes, paragraph 4, and that's it. That frames the issues. It also tells you SIAC's finding, which was against the government, on the facts before it. On the facts before it. And it's also interesting that it was because of potential future events, the possibilities that the MOU might not be observed in the future. And then the Court of Appeal sets out the four grounds of appeal from SIAC. Paragraph 5. If I can take you forward then to 22, second sentence, or sorry, third sentence of the quotation. This is common ground. The correct test is where substantial grounds are shown that the individual respondents in place of buildings suffer mistreatment contrary to Article 3 are on return to Libya. It was common ground from Simon, that the correct, that was the correct test, and then it's common ground. And that's what it was common ground alone before SIAC in this case as well.
But Mr. Hickman, forgive me, isn't that because in a deportation case the appellant is in the territory of the UK and therefore undoubtedly falls within the jurisdiction of the UK, therefore the obligations in Section 6 of the Human Rights Act apply directly? Whereas here, we're dealing with a voluntarily adopted policy. So what SIAC has done is simply say, well, given that the Secretary of State didn't have to have this policy in the first place, but has chosen to have it, has she gone about applying it in a rational way?
First point is that the point of the policy was not to practice.
mistake, but I'm not sure I would necessarily accept that proposition. This is an issue which has arisen frequently in the context of planning law, and the leading authority in the Supreme Court is Tesco Stores and Dundee City Council. It's quite true to say, as you have submitted, that the interpretation of a policy is now authoritatively to be regarded as an issue of law. So it's a matter for the court to decide. But the application of a policy, say in the planning context, is not regarded as an issue on which the court should form its own view, and it engages in a traditional witness-free review.
Speculate about risks in other countries
Lord Justice Flaux? Lord Justice Singh?
No, thank you.
No, thank you very much indeed, Mr. Hickman. Yes, Mr. James, I think we can see you. Can everybody? Both. Somewhat muffled, but I'm sure none the worse for that.
shocked by finding somebody else's heads in pins,
Thank you.
Sir James, can I... Sir James, can I ask you about this? Suppose, and I know that these are not the facts of this case, but just to test the point of legal principle, suppose the facts were that SIAT doesn't just decide this as a preliminary issue, but goes on to decide the appeal. So it does look at the national security case and reaches that, let's suppose the decision is adverse to the appellant. On your submission, as a matter of legal principle, what should the Court of Appeal then do if there's an appeal from such a decision? Well, Sir James, I don't want to take you out of order at all, so please do come back to these points at the appropriate juncture. But can I just flag up something else which has been in my mind? You say, I think, that one may have to wait to see what happens, and I understand that point. But from the appellant's point of view, deprivation of nationality could be said to be having not just potential consequences in the future, like which country she can go to. It could be said that it's having an immediate effect on her now, because, for example, the nationality of a person determines which state they can approach for consular assistance and things of that sort. My understanding from the papers we've read is that there are some detainees in Syria who are being afforded consular assistance by European states. That may include the UK, I think. But in any event, the principle is clear that there is a relationship between a national and their own state, which gives rise to the possibility of consular assistance. Now, if one just waits to see, then could it be said that this appellant is right now being deprived of the benefits of nationality at a time when it's not possible for this issue to be fairly determined?
But isn't one of the things that court might take into account the circumstances in which, as you put it, she chose to leave the country, which might involve findings of fact one way or the other as to whether she was or was not groomed, and the state of affairs and her exercise of her genuine free will when she got there, and the long-term recognised effects of radicalisation, which don't just kind of disappear.
Well, Lady, the answer to that question is yes, of course.
Yes.
But that can't be the news of the tail or the bag of the dog.
No, but on the other hand, when the heart of your submissions, or at least a very strong part of your submissions, is this is all a self-inflicted wound, does one not have, can you just put it like that, or does that not go to one of the actual difficulties of all of this, is that she's not had an opportunity because of her, you say, current inability to have an effective appeal and to give proper instructions to allow SIAC or anyone else, including us, to put that into context?
Because that's the premise that you're considering. So a question can't be without.
I don't want to take you out of turn, it's just that I want to... Yes, thank you.
Submit that the question of my own pose permits a guarantee of answer on the facts. Self-created problems, if that deprivation cannot lawfully today,
Certainly, Sir James. Thank you very much indeed. Very well. 11 o'clock tomorrow morning, please. If I could ask again if people could log in a little earlier so that the clerks and so on can try and make sure everything's working fine so we can start promptly. Thank you very much. Good evening, everyone.